Father God, we come before you this morning still with heavy hearts, Lord, and realizing that this world that we live in is a dark place, that there's tragedy, that there's sadness, Lord. Sadness that words can't even begin to describe. But God, you know that. You know that about our world. You know that about this life. And you acted so that there would be light here, that you would come among us as well. Father, in the midst of this tragedy, we pray that you would draw our attention to you. We pray for the Nikkanen family. Lord, we pray for the Corman family as well. And for all of Zach's friends, for all of Jeff's friends. God, we know that you are a God who is living and active in this world. But Lord, we also know that there is a resurrection as well. And as we grieve not as those who have no hope, but as those who have hope because of what you have done. So Lord, we pray that you would teach us to grieve in a way that draws us closer to you in the days and weeks ahead. All these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And as we get, we'll open this service this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we remember again that we are being brought into the presence of the Lord this morning as we gather together as brothers and sisters in Christ, the call to worship this morning is from Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 20. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before him. And I know that's kind of contradictory to say, now let's stand and sing our opening hymn this morning. But as we pause and reflect and think of the fact that God is bringing us, inviting us here to be in his presence, it's a place we don't deserve, and frankly, a place that we don't belong. But because of the work of Christ, because of what he has done, it's a place that Christ commands us to come and invites us to come, and a place where Christ says, you belong here. So as we think of that, I invite you to stand as we sing our opening hymn on this Reformation Sunday, hymn number 141, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, hymn number 141 in the blue hymnal. Thank you. beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed. Whereupon we come for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who has given your only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake, grant us remission of all our sins, and by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, that by your grace we may come to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us of all our sins. To them that believe on his name, he gives a right to become the sons of God and bestows on them his Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, O Lord, unto us all. Be seated.
My Christian friends, I'd invite you to follow along with our Old Testament lesson this morning. And if you'd open your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 65, we'll read verses 1 and 2. That can be found on page 1162. Beginning at verse 1. I revealed myself to those who did not ask for me. I was found by those who did not seek me. To a nation that did not call on my name, I said, "Here I am, here am I." All day long I held up my hands to an obstinate people who walk in ways not good, pursuing their own imaginations. And our second lesson is found in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 through 21, and that's on page 1823. Ephesians 5, beginning at verse 15. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Sends our readings.
The gospel reading for this morning can be found on page 1534 in your pew Bibles. It's Matthew chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. Again, that can be found on page 1534, Matthew chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. And I'll invite you to stand out of respect for the gospel if you're able to.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Matthew chapter 22, beginning at verse 1, reading in Jesus' name. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, 'Tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fattened cattle have been butchered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. Go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find.' So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, both good and bad, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing wedding clothes. 'Friend,' he asked, 'how did you get in here without wedding clothes?' The man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, 'Tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen.'" Here ends the gospel reading this morning.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
You join with me in confessing our Christian faith together with the words of the Apostles' Creed. And that can be found on page 32 in your blue hymnals. So you join with Christians across all time and all space here confessing our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Our next hymn is hymn number 260 in the blue hymnal, as we remember again the Reformation Sunday and the benefit of having God's word in our own language, that we are able to read it and to know it. Will you join with me in singing hymn number 260, "Lord, Keep Us Steadfast in Thy Word"? Around 15 years ago, there was a group from the Washington Post that wanted to test a theory. The theory was this, that people look without really seeing what's in front of them. And to prove this, or to show this, they conducted a social experiment. They brought in one of the world's most famous violinists to a Washington, D.C. subway station to play during rush hour. They wanted to see if people would stop, pause, and recognize the beauty that was before them, or if the hustle and bustle of everyday life just permitted them to keep on going. So Joshua Bell played his $3 million violin for a total of 47 minutes. A total number of nearly 1,100 people rushed by him in their morning commute, and only six stopped to listen. And for a matter of minutes, not for the whole 47 minutes, but just for a couple of minutes, the longest of them stopping to listen for 6 minutes. During that time, as he had a little case, seeing how much money he would raise from this experiment, he was made a little over $32. And here was arguably one of the world's greatest living violinists performing incognito, and hardly anyone stopped to listen. Just three nights earlier, he played for a sold-out house in Boston. And you don't have to be a fan of classical music or even violin to have recognized the skill with which Bell played. But still, only six people paused. Then they continued on their merry way, heading to work. The social experiment successfully showed how oblivious people can be. You don't have to be in a hurry to catch a train to be oblivious. Wherever you are, life continues to pass you by. The people we walk by are precious, eternal human souls. But we can get so tunnel-visioned at times that we forget that. We slap a label on someone and we instantly think and know, I know everything about this person. They're from Hebron, and everyone from Hebron is all the same, right? Or they're from Ruskin, they're from Deschler, they're from Byron. And we put people in this box without ever getting to know them. Yet each person has unique experiences. Each person has unique burdens, ideas, convictions, hurts, joys, and value that we are often oblivious to. We see a box. We see what we want to see. And just like the people in the subway station who saw just another peddling musician, not one of the world's greatest violinists, playing renowned music on a piece of an instrument that's worth more money than I'll make in my lifetime. When what we see doesn't meet our expectations, we often keep on walking by. And the same is true when it comes to our preconceived ideas about God. We have our own ideas of how God operates, and everything works nicely when he works in accordance with the box that we set up for the Lord. We put him in a box for easy access for when we need him. Many ideas about God come from stories passed from one person to the next without ever checking the biblical text to see, is that really true? Or is it just an old wives' tale that's been passed on? It's the easy way. Rather than a robust understanding of who God is and how he operates, we reduce our understanding of God to meme theology. Short, simple sayings that we like to hear. Whether or not they're true is irrelevant. It's what I want to hear, and that's what I'm going to cling to. This morning, we're going to look at God's Word and see, again, who God has revealed himself to be. If you have your Bibles, I'll invite you to turn to Isaiah 65, verses 1 through 2. Isaiah 65, verses 1 through 2. And again, if you're able, I'll invite you to stand out of respect for God's Word. Isaiah 65, 1 through 2, reading in Jesus' name. I permitted myself to be sought by those who did not ask for me. I permitted myself to be found by those who did not seek me. I said, here am I, here am I. To a nation which did not call on my name, I have spread out my hands all day long to a rebellious people who walk in the way which is not good, following their own thoughts. Father God, these are your words, and your word is true. We pray this morning that you would sanctify us in your truth today. Lord, that you would draw our attention to you this morning, that we would see that you are there standing with arms wide open, calling us to yourself. All these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. As you read through the Old Testament, the story of God's people can be equal parts infuriating and humbling. Reading through the text, everything seems so black and white, so clear, and so obvious, and we see all of history kind of being reduced down to a couple of different books for us. But when you filter in the everyday experiences of life, the message begins to get a little muted, when you start to imagine that these are real people with real lives and real stresses and things that were going on in their lives at the time that Scripture was being written, that God was working amongst His people, the message gets muffled a little bit. Because the people are too busy to stop and smell the roses, or in this case, too busy to stop and to study God's Word and to know who God is. And after all, we have them all figured out. They had God all figured out. He's in that box for when we need Him. And He'll just stay right there. The Lord is speaking to His people in Isaiah 65. And He is the one who has faithfully provided for His people again and again. Since the beginning of time, starting with creation, He created the heavens and the earth, the sky, the stars, the land, the water, the vegetation. He created life. He provided instruction, provided grace, He provided freedom, provided hope, meaning, and significance. All of these things the Lord has graciously provided for His people. And what have His people done with it? They squandered it. The time of Isaiah, that's exactly what they were doing. They were squandering this rich history of God at work in them and amongst them and saying, you know what, God, that's all great and fine, but I'd rather have you in this box so that I can come and get you when I need you. But right now I'm doing all right. His people squandered it all, choosing instead to go after false gods, fake gods that offered them nothing more than placebos and momentary pleasure. And in the end, just resulted in death. They ignored Him, choosing instead to cling to their own superstitions. They built the box for the Lord to be kept in, and they wanted Him to stay right there. But God would have none of it. God sent His prophets to call His people back to Himself. And again, God sent prophet after prophet, as we read in the gospel parable that Jesus is saying, the king sent His messengers to call people, and what happened? They were murdered, but God sent more messengers. All the while, His people walked right on by. Yet God never stopped caring. He never stopped calling, and He never stopped sending out His messengers. In verse 2 of our text, this points to God's patient persistence. He says, I have spread out my hands all day long to a rebellious people who walk in a way which is not good, following their own thoughts. Just a few chapters earlier, Isaiah summarizes the history of God's people. In chapter 63, verses 7 through 9, he says this, I shall make mention of the loving kindnesses of the Lord, recognizing that the Lord is giving His loving kindness to His people. And so Isaiah pauses and he mentions that for a little bit, the praises of the Lord, according to all that the Lord has granted us, and the great goodness toward the house of Israel, which He has granted them, according to His compassion, and according to the abundance of His loving kindnesses. For He said, surely they are my people, sons who will not deal falsely. And so He became their Savior. In all their affliction He was afflicted, and the angel of His presence saved them. In His love and in His mercy He redeemed them, and He lifted them and carried them all the days of old. This is the God who is calling out to His people. This is the loving kindness of the Lord being extended. That was how it was meant to be. That was how it was supposed to go from the beginning of time. Had Adam and Eve never sinned in the garden, this is what it was supposed to look like. And God sent His prophets and people to work, call His people back to Himself. This is how it was supposed to go. The text continues in verse 10. But they rebelled and grieved His Holy Spirit. In light of all of God's goodness, in light of all of God's provision, in light of all of God's grace, how do His people respond? With thankfulness and joy? No, they rebelled and went their own way, grieving His Holy Spirit. It didn't take long before His people started following their own thoughts, walking in their own way, going back to their rebellious ways. God, I know You've said this, but I kind of like this idea over here. So I'm just going to do this for a little while. You stay over there, and I'll come back for you when I need you sometime, but I've got things figured out. All the while, God waits with arms open wide, declaring, here I am. Here am I. Come to me. The people respond in the opposite way. They choose rebellion over comfort. They choose their own way over God's. God is kept in that box, kept in his box, and they go their merry way. They don't need God, not now. And others react more strongly. They spit and they mock. They utter curses at the Lord with God's arms wide open, saying, "Here am I, come to me." And they spit in his face and say, "No, thank you." We aren't too different. We're not much better. God is still standing with arms wide open to us, and our actions proclaim loudly, "It's nothing personal, God. I'm just a little busy right now. When things settle down, I'll come back. I know where to find you." Or maybe, "Thanks for the offer. I'm doing okay at the moment. I don't really need you, but when I need you, it's nice to know where you are, and it's nice to know where I can go when I need your help." It's kind of just what we do, isn't it? We follow our own thoughts, and we go our own way, because we don't want to see how vulnerable we truly are. We don't want to recognize the rebellious thoughts that they are, and for what they are, rebellious thoughts against the Lord. The people continue to walk their own way. How does God respond? What do we see in this text in Isaiah 65? Does God sit back idly, being unengaged with the affairs of the world, and say, "Fine, have it your way. Go ahead and do whatever you want to do. I'm not going to intervene anymore. I'm not even going to bother trying anymore." What does Isaiah say in the text? Or the Lord say through Isaiah, "I permitted myself to be sought by those who did not ask for me. I permitted myself to be found by those who did not seek me." God is saying here, "I would seek out a people who aren't seeking me." Not only does he say he permitted himself to be sought, but he goes so far as to even say to be found. These are people who aren't looking for the Lord, and yet somehow they find the Lord. And how? It's not because one day they decided, "You know what, I think I'm going to look for the Lord today." It's because God takes action to make this happen. God seeks them out. God seeks us out while we have no thought, care, or concern for him whatsoever. The Lord had made himself available to his people through the prophets, through the priests, through the worship in the temple. And then nearly 700 years after Isaiah has prophesied, God would more fully act on these verses. As God enters into our world, having been conceived by the Holy Spirit, taking on human flesh, in the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus became both the Son of God and the Son of Man. And Jesus came and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. He was as real and as present as you and I are today. You look around and say, "Oh, there's Jesus, the Son of God, the Son of Man," if you recognized him as such. God came to be with us. He ate, he drank, he slept, he wept. He talked, he loved, he worked. He traveled. God entered into our world. He entered into our suffering. He entered into our pain. He entered into our broken and fallen world, all the while extending his arms and saying, "Here I am." And how did the world respond? Did the world go running immediately to him? John summarizes it in this way, saying, "He came to his own, and his own did not receive him." His mom wasn't given any royal birthing suite, even though the Savior of the nations was being born. Herod felt threatened, and so he tried killing him by killing all the male toddlers and infants there in Bethlehem. People openly rejected him and mocked him. They sought to stone him, push him off a cliff, expel him, murder him, betray him, reject him, and ultimately crucify him. And how did Christ respond? Again, he doesn't say, "Fine, have it your way." He doesn't just go away and say, "It's not worth it anymore. You don't understand. These people, I'm trying to do a nice thing for them, and they don't even want it, so why am I here?" Well, he knows that all of this would happen. He knows that he is seeking after a lost and dying people who aren't looking for him. He knows that he's going after a people who are continuing to live in rebellion against him. He knows all of this would happen even before his conception, and he still came. He still humbled himself to be born as an infant, to learn the things that we had to learn, to grow up being needy and submitting to his parents in all things. He came for this very purpose, to be the once and for all sacrifice for our sins, even the sins of those who sought to kill him. The sins of those who spat in his face, who rejected him. The sins of those who should know better. To his own who did not receive him, Christ came to die for them. He came to seek and to save the lost, many of whom having absolutely no idea that they're lost. Having absolutely no idea that they needed a Savior. And they continued walking their merry own way, following after their own thoughts. And yet Christ is here saying, "Here I am." Jesus was found by a people who weren't looking for him. The lady at the well that day was just looking for some water. And what did she find? She found living water in Christ. That lady who couldn't keep a husband, Jesus finds her. Nathanael, who was convinced that nothing good could come from Nazareth, and Jesus says, "I saw you sitting under the tree before you even knew I was coming. I saw you, I knew you." Nathanael finds Jesus even though he's not looking for him. Think of Saul as well. On his way to murder Christians, he loses his sight, but he finds the Lord. He's not looking for Christ, but Christ finds him. Maybe this is best pictured, the love of Christ, and that thief on the cross who's being rightfully crucified for the convictions that he has done, or for the wrong things that he has done. He wasn't looking for Jesus that day, but there on the cross, he says, "Father, remember, Jesus, remember me when you enter into your kingdom." Jesus is there, literally dying on his cross for this man's sins. Jesus goes to the extent to be crucified next to a criminal to seek and to save the lost, people who aren't looking for himself, all the while saying, "Here I am." And the list continues on. This is the heart. This is a conviction of Jesus to come to seek and to save the lost, even to those who weren't looking for him. And there Christ hung, suspended for all the world to see, his hands physically stuck, spread out, voluntarily. Jesus does this voluntarily. And for what? For what purpose? What did Christ possibly have to gain in that ugly death? Absolutely nothing. But you and I, and to all those rebellious people who aren't looking for Christ, who would rather keep God in a box for someday down the road when we might need him in the future, we had everything to gain. And so Christ came. He entered our world. He took on our pain. He took on our burdens. That we might have life, that we might be forgiven. And we can say that's all wonderful. But where is he now? Where is he in the darkest nights? Where is he when tragedy strikes? Where is he when I cannot see him, when I can't hear him, when I can't touch him? Where was God on Monday night? Where was God? What's the answer to that question? We go two places to answer that question. The first place that we go, because it's the easiest place for us to go, is we go to that box. That box that we've built for God, and we say, "God, you stay here." And we say, "God, you should have been here. Because these are the things that I know that I demand that you should do in this situation. But you're in that box here, God. Who are you? Where are you?" That's one place we go. The God in the box exists to make our lives easier, to make us feel better, to be the scapegoat for us when tragedy hits, to take our pain, to comfort us when we suddenly don't know what to do anymore. It's something to hold on to when we have nothing, something to take our pain, something to comfort us when we suddenly don't know what to do. The God in the box is just a glorified teddy bear or security blanket for us. And we keep him in a box because we don't want anyone else to know about it, because you and I are both too old for teddy bears and blankets. But when we really need something, it's usually the first place we go. We go to that box, and we start making demands of God and saying, "God, you should have been someplace else. You should have done something else because I had other expectations." That's the place where our emotions go, where our feelings go. But that's not who God is. And there's a better place to go when troubles hit. We go to God himself, not the God that we've fashioned for ourselves, but the God who is, the God who reveals himself to us, the God who has created heavens and the earth, the God of the Bible. We look to the God's word, and what do we find? What has God said in the midst of trials? Where is he? "I'm with you, always." You find that God is here with his arms open wide, continuing to welcome a rebellious people, continuing to permit himself to be found by those who didn't seek for him, continuing to seek and to save the lost. He didn't abandon us. He didn't flee when times got difficult, but he entered into our pain. He enters into our pain. We look to God's word. We read about Christ's incarnation, and we see that God took on flesh to dwell among us. He lived, he died, he rose again, he ascended into heaven. But he didn't say, see you later, guys. I'm out of here. I'm not going to be around anymore. He again establishes his presence on earth, and he leaves behind a witness. Jesus told his disciples before he left that it's going to be better off for them when he leaves. It doesn't seem like it now. You won't believe it, but I'm sending a helper who is going to come. Rather than living amongst you, I will be inside you as the Holy Spirit takes residence in our own hearts and lives. He would not leave them to themselves, but send the helper, the Holy Spirit, to lead and guide us into all truth. And Jesus promises to be with us always, even to the end of the age. There aren't any caveats there. It's all the time Christ will be with us. He's given us his word. He's given us his promise. He comforts us. He guides us. He nourishes. He sustains. He calls. He gathers. He enlightens. He reveals himself. And he's also left behind this today, the congregation, the gathering of believers to be the hands and feet of Jesus, the body of Christ, in this world where darkness can seem to be overwhelming. He places believers as beacons of light. And where you go, as he dwells inside you, there Christ goes as well. To bring the hope and healing of Jesus, to proclaim and declare that God is not kept in a box, but he is here among us. And as believers in Christ, we bring that presence of Christ with us wherever we go. And as we enter into the dark situations so often found here in this world, Christ comes with us, all the while with arms wide open, permitting himself to be sought by those who aren't looking for him, permitting himself to be found by those who don't ask for him, declaring, I am here, I'm with you, I've come. Unfortunately, we don't always see it that way. We fail to see it because we're content with keeping God in that box, because we know where to find him then. We fail to see it because we're busy running from one thing to the next thing. Yet God is here within our very midst, seeking out, calling to himself, and comforting with his presence all day long to a rebellious people, intent on walking their own ways, intent on following their own thoughts. Do you see him? Do you recognize him? Do you recognize the beauty before our very eyes here this morning, that Christ is here among us just as he has promised? He is at work here calling people to himself. He is at work here calling people to himself through you and in you, permitting himself to be found by those who did not ask for him and found by those who haven't sought him out either. This is what God is doing in and through the congregation, the body of Christ, alive and well in the world today. As we go out into the darkness of this world, we bring the light of Christ. Christ has come. Christ has arisen. And Christ will come again. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word and for its truth. God, as we look to your word, we're challenged. We're challenged because we have our own ideas of how you work and how you operate. But Lord, you work in the way that you have revealed yourself in Scripture. God, you didn't just come for those who are seeking you out, but you came to find those who aren't even looking for you. We thank you and we praise you, Lord, for that. Thank you for coming for us, that while we were yet sinners, you died for us. God, with no benefit for yourself, no glory in it for you. Lord, that we might have something to gain, that we would have eternal life. So, Father, we thank you for sending your Son. Jesus, we thank you for being willing to put up with all of that and to endure the suffering and the shame for our sakes. And, Lord, for the sake of those who continue to hold, to walk to their own ways and walk away from you, to continue in their rebellious thoughts, God, we pray that when we do the same thing, that you would call us back to yourself, that we would see you entering into our pain. We'd see your love, we'd see your grace, we'd see your forgiveness. And Lord, we would know that you are still calling us back to yourself, that we would come running back to you. All these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. This time we'll take our offering. Our church offering is will be in the plates, and then our Sunday school offering is going to Andrew and Alexis Olson, and that basket is in the back there. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask that you would lead us not into temptation. We know that you tempt no one to sin, but we pray that you would guard and preserve us, that the devil, the world, and our own flesh may not deceive us, nor lead us into error and unbelief, to despair, and other great and shameful sins, but that when we are tempted, we may finally prevail and gain the victory through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. God, as we give back to you a portion of the gifts that you've blessed us with, we pray that you would use these gifts to further your kingdom, Lord, that we would be about the work that you've called us to do, of rebuilding that temple of living stones, Father. We pray that you'd be with those listed in our bulletins who are going through various health concerns, for Lauren, Donovan, Connie, Alan, Dave, Judy, Annie, Kim, Jan, Karen, Deb, Lord, for everyone else who's going through various issues, for whether it's cancer or illnesses, or Lord, injuries or surgeries. We pray, Father, that you would, in your grace and in your mercy, be with them, draw near to them, and heal them according to your will. We pray for all of those who are with child. We think of Cassidy, Lord. We praise you for this new life. We pray that you would watch over her, and we pray for a safe delivery, Lord, as well, and that child would grow up to love and serve you all of his or her days. We do lift up to you, Lord, the families in our communities who are mourning the loss of loved ones. We think of the Corman family, for the Nickanen family. Lord, we pray for all of their friends and relatives as well. Lord, in grief, we don't know where to turn. But we know, Lord, that you are still here among us with your arms wide open, calling us to yourself, seeking to comfort us. We thank you, Lord, that you entered into our pain. Father, help us to find comfort in you today. We pray that you'd be with the residents of our nursing homes and assisted living, for Edna, for Helen, for Marjorie. Lord, watch over them and draw near to them. We pray also for our students, and for all the faculty and staff at our schools. Lord, we pray for Jenna, for CJ, for Samuel, Brendan, Evan, Judith, for myself. Father, we pray that you would continue to grow us into the servants you are calling us to be and equip us as well, Lord, for whatever task it is that you have in store for us. We pray for all of those who are serving in our military, both overseas and at home. Lord, we pray for Aaron and for Andrew, and pray for all the veterans too, Lord. Watch over them and protect them and keep them safe. Father, we thank you for our country. We pray that you would be with our leaders, Lord, that you would keep them safe. God, that you would give them your wisdom. Lord, we pray for the elections coming up as well, that your will would be done. For any elected official who doesn't know you, Lord, that they would come to know you, and that they would submit to your will as well, that they would see that you are calling them to a certain task, and that, Lord, that they would be faithful in that. We pray, Lord, for our police, that you would watch over them and protect them, and we pray for justice as they seek to do their jobs as well, Lord. We pray that you would continue to protect us as they seek to do their jobs. Lord, we pray for our communities too. We are hurting right now, God. We pray for comfort. Lord, we pray for revival as well. We pray that you would show us the hope that you have come to bring, that we would know this hope, that we would find comfort and meaning in it as well. We pray for all of those affected by the tragedies around the world. Lord, draw near to them today. We pray for our AFLC and for our Association Retreat Center. Lord, be with that ministry and for all of those who are retreating to that place. God, we pray that you would find them there through your word and through your spirit and encourage them and strengthen them for the work that you have for them to do. We pray for our persecuted brothers and sisters around the world who aren't able to worship as freely as we are. God, go before them, encourage them, and strengthen them, and be with their persecutors as well, Lord, that they too would know that you are opening up your arms to them, that you came to save them too. We pray for our seminary interns, Lord, that you would lead and guide them to the ministries you're calling them, but in the meantime, Father, that you would grow them to be pastors after your own heart. And Lord, we do pray that you would provide pastors for all of our congregations that don't have pastors. Raise up more men, Lord, who fear you and who love you and who love the congregation and love ministering in your kingdom, Lord. We pray that you'd be with Andrew and Alexis Olson and for their family. And God, we pray that you would give Andrew the contacts needed to be able to translate your word into languages that don't have any scripture. Go before them, Lord. And through his ministry, we pray that you would extend your arms even further to a people who don't know you, that they might know you. And they might know your love and your care for them, your desire to save them. Father, we pray that you would hear us now as we pray together the prayer that you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is in the Gray Hymnal, hymn number 193, Jesus, Thy Blood and Righteousness, hymn number 193 in the Gray Hymnal.